it's they're playing regularly, they could get them out of it, but yeah. You know, Steve seems to go on and
there's
on
a partnership, they've been together a few years, yeah, haven't they? You know, they like anything, so they know each other's game inside out, and that's probably why they're not letting many goals in, you know, it's a big factor for them.
Well, we need a market one, Staines Town one.
Again, on paper, you might have called a draw there if you was gonna. You know, Needham just keep the good run going.
Yeah.
You know, we keep saying it's difficult up there, but you know they're in it for the longer one. That's I think for Staines, you'll be quite happy with that result.
Yeah, because I think they lost the last couple by the odd goal and that. So
yeah, I've just seen Lauren Hamichi was up front for Staines.
No.
Yeah, was he really? That's what it's played up front for Staines, so which is a little bit of a surprise. He's not been played in the Ryman League for a while. He's been about
Kenfield United this year.
Been about, so that's what
step six.
And this is a different line, I think. But he's
can't be two of them, can he?
he's pedigree is decent in that league. Yeah,
well, we'll say before we go to the last one, if you hear any noise in the background, it is due to the fact we're at Harlow tonight. There is a live game going on in the Essex Senior League between Eton Manor and Enfield 1893, and we are right next door to the Eton Manor dressing room. So if you do hear any anything, any bad language or anything, do apologise now. But Tonbridge Angels 3, Hendon 1.
It's not a shock, it's a good result for Tonbridge, keeps them amongst it. But yeah, it's something they just need to keep building on, something to keep in with them.
Again, they're going to be in and around it. I mean,
they've got games in hand, haven't they?
Yeah. I mean, my mate Georgie Benham got his first goal, and I spoke to him after the game. He said they didn't play great, but as you know, we said earlier, a win's a win.
Of course,
you know, and that's all that matters. And they've been a little bit inconsistent, I think, over Christmas, winning here and then drawing there, losing there, and you know, they should be beating Hendon at home.
I just see if you look at Tunbridge's side, you know, Nathan Elder. You've got Damien Scallon and obviously Alexander, of course, the Maidstone fella.
Yeah.
That's some forward line.
Then you throw Bluden into the mix.
He's on the bench, and obviously then you've still got Tommy Whitnall, who scores goals for fun, you know, and even Ugo, you know, he's played for Bromley.
Yeah.
Right back, on I had him years ago. But, yeah. You know, they've got that's a big old side they've got, decent side there, Tonbridge.
Well, we just had Carl Bates text us, said, long live Soho, he's a Soho Town fan, and he'll be with us in a few weeks' time, hopefully, on the 4th of February. Ryman Division 1 North then, Great Wakeham Rovers nil, Dereham Town 5, but of course the story, I suppose, behind that is the fact that the chairman was running the line once again.
Yeah, Nick's obviously much, but he didn't keep up with play for 400 goals. I actually thought he might have been at our game, because that's our line, I had the same issue. But listen, you know, he must have his kit in the car.
Why do you end up?
He's a ref, isn't he? He's a ref.
Right.
And the linesman went down injured or was unwell, and
he's doing it in his suit. With his,
I did speak to the ref, because the referee, Dan, was coming on the show in a couple of weeks' time. And so I spoke to him during the week and said to him, how did he do? He said, no, he didn't do too badly. Unfortunately, today, Dan's come back to me today to tell me that he's had a call from the FA, and the FA have told him that he's not allowed on the programme. So,
oh, okay.
What about
thank you, FA. The other game he was lining, how'd they get on in that game? Lost as well?
I've no idea.
He does enjoy it. He's a Sunday morning.
Yeah, he's
fish, a lot, yeah. He does a lot. Quite he's rough. He must like it. But it's great that he's done. Yeah, he's stepped in and done it for us.
That ain't a great result for him, though, is it?
It ain't something you can't exactly give him an ode of grief and all from the sideline, can you? Because you're definitely going to get.
Did he do it last week as well, then? Yeah, because they lost 5-0 last week, didn't
they? Yeah, they did 2 5-0s on a round there, on the bounce. Yeah, or Dereham lost 5-0 the week before as well.
Yeah.
So they, two of them had lost 5-0 and then gone into that game.
Did he play Jamie Garner?
Jamie played, no, he didn't score. He obviously left us, you know. So, yeah, I'm just looking at their side now, and they've got obviously Steve Butterworth going up front, as well, he's been about, so.
But they're in a bit of a rut, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. Yeah, but so, to be fair, as like I said, Dereham got a hammer in last week, so.
Yeah.
That's a strange one.
Mm. Well, while we're on that subject, I know we're off the subject and we're live on an air, but give Kelly a text. She wanted to know what the thing was to watch the show. So, as you have her number, you can give her a text.
Go on, Keith.
Haybridge Swiss 2, Bowles and Pitsy 2. Yeah. Haybridge Swiss 2, Bowles and Pitsy 2. Both in the studio last week.
It's a surprise, obviously, because Bowles are doing well. Obviously, they lost the game last week as well. It was meant to be a great game against Brighton. You know, we had Hay Virginia as well, and I think that's a decent point for them.
Yeah, that is a good point. Yeah. I think we played Bowers 6 weeks ago.
I thought that was a good side.
Mm, really good side, you know. Yeah. Dangerous up front. He had a boy playing out on the left hand side. He was massive. They hit him a lot. Mm. And yeah, he hurt us, didn't he? Mm. You know?
Three penalties in that game. 53rd minute penalty, 85 and 90.
Well, there was three the game before against Brighton, you see, sending off, two sending offs in the end.
We have one against us every week.
We've got to get in the box together.
I mean, we played Abridge probably about early November, I think it was, and they were pretty poor. I mean, I said that to Jody last week, but I've seen them a few times since, and they have improved. And I mean,
George Cole, I think he's a good player.
Yeah, and they've got Ed Youssef up front as well. And I think, you know, that's a very decent player. I said Bowers have been very good.
Bowers are strong,
they're
a great first season.
But I think they have improved. We've got them Saturday, Haybridge, so expecting a bit, you know, a much tougher game than
home or away.
At home.
They've got some good players, to be fair. As you said, you know, it's not as doom and gloom over there. And I think Jody made that point. You know, when you get, if you've got Asa Youssef there and things like that, you're not going to be struggling too much.
Exactly. So,
is that the boy who's at Chatham?
Chatham, yeah, he's gone there on loan, so you know, it's not, they're not that sad, but they would be happy with that point. I think Bowers would,
he's two
drop points for them.
We've got some names watching at the minute, but manager at Brighton Saloon, James Webster's on there. Welcome, Alex Reid's there, so he's Luke Callender, and so he's the Isle of goalkeeper, David Hughes as well. So welcome to all of you guys. Well, of course, you all know yourself what happened to this one. Phoenix Sports 1, Thurrock 1.
Let the boys go, because it's their home game.
That was a shock.
It's a shock. I was expecting the smash.
To be fair,
I was expecting to get smashed up.
To be fair, when we played them at their place earlier in the season last year, 4-0, and we were slaughtered on the day, weren't we? They absolutely wrecked us. Is it Cali?
And when we see him, say, was you surprised that you weren't on the team sheet?
Yeah, when I see the team sheet and he was sub, we was like, because he pulled all the strings that day, and he was superb, and we was chasing shadows.
So you were sending off though, didn't it?
Probably. Yeah, he did take the piss a little bit in the home game. And to be fair, when I spoke to the manager afterwards, maybe that was in his thinking why he didn't play him. Because he was a little bit showboating at the end of the game. But from my point of view, Thurrock, good side, played excellent. They played good football, but our keeper in the first half done well, made a couple of good saves. But then, to be honest, everything he did after that, although they had a lot of the ball, most of the possession, their striking, it was a bit toothless, a little bit, nothing was really, all the saves he made, our keeper, I thought, were comfortable. And then second half, obviously we got a goal, which was a fantastic finish from Tyrus Gordon. I mean, I don't know what your keeper was doing really. He sort of came out and passed it straight to him. He's off his line, and he's pinged it. He's got it straight in the top corner. It was great goal.
Our build up to the game, obviously taking the away game into consideration. I thought if we turned it into a football match, we'd get beat. You know, I think they're a fantastic footballing team. So I said to the boys before the game, I said, we've got to accept that we ain't going to have much of the ball here today. But what we have got to do, we've got to be disciplined, and we've got to make sure we're going to make it hard for you guys. When we played them away, we pressed quite high. We was going in, diving in, and we was getting picked off. So we can't afford that to happen today. And we made two banks of four. I thought our discipline and our defensive shape was good. And we got moved about a lot, but second half, our goalkeeper didn't really make any saves. And, you know, yes, the possession was ridiculous, really. But, you know, I said to my boys, Leicester won the Premier League last year, and they didn't. Yeah. Their possession last year winning the Premier League, it ain't all about that.
No.
And we could, you know, with a little bit of luck, you know, your goalkeeper's pushed one onto the post with a one-on-one near the end light, you know. But for us, we're over the moon with a point.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've been on an 11-game unbeaten run. If you'd have said that when we lost to Brighton, so you're going to win 9 and draw 2, you'd have gone, that's brilliant. Yeah. You know, the boys were disappointed after, obviously. Yeah, I mean, I agree, we had the majority of the possession.
Definitely, yeah.
The clear-cut chances we had before the first goal went in, on another day, you two, maybe 3-0 up. But at the end of, you know, you've got to take them.
You've got to take
and that's exactly what I said during the game. I said, the guys hit 40-yard worldie, He's yeah. taking that chance. We didn't. And that's football, isn't it?
You know, we had a couple of chances early.
Was you surprised, yeah. Glenn, that Dave didn't play? Obviously, I know part of it, but yeah. with what's going on, obviously, he's a big player. And,
he is, yeah. We just had a discussion, and, you know, it did come up in conversation. Like, we didn't want any sort of, like, hidden agendas, you know, and we just thought, you know, it might have taken away the emphasis of what we was trying to do, you know, and that was, you know, part of the thinking behind it. But, you know, I mean, he's played a lot of games and the gaffer's good at mixing it up, and, you know, we had Ronnie playing in there, and Ronnie's a very good young player as well.
He's all good on the ball, good.
Yeah, I think, you know, I think Ronnie will be a player in 2-3 years' time that can maybe kick on and go up a couple of leagues, as his brother who came in for the first time at left centre-half. And, you know, but like I said, that's football. We had the lion's share of the possession, didn't score. You boys scored, and that's it. It's football. And, you know, again, we were 2-0 down last week, showed character to come back. But, you know, I agree with Andy and Steve. Like, second half, we had a lot of the ball. It was just the final ball that let us down, really, you know. And
would you say that's 2 points got, though, or was that a good point for you?
No, because we know they're a good side. So, you know, sometimes you've got to go to them places where you're playing against good teams and pick up a point. We haven't lost. The boys after, I've got to be honest, surprised me. I've bowled in, you know, like, kind of, well done, boys, keep the run going, that's 11. They're all sitting there like, oh, but that's 2 games we ain't won. You know, like, that's how hungry they are to win games. And it was good to see that.
Yeah.
But, you know, over the season, we're going to drop points. The ones around us, they're all going to drop points. So just keep racking up the points by the end of the season.
You know, that's what we're going to look at.
You know.
For yourself, Steve, obviously, you've got Tyrus in, which I know really well. And it's funny, like, he played with me and he struggled with goals, but he goes to Thames Meade, scores in his debut, comes to you and scores in his debut. it just shows, you know, something go your way.
Yeah. Just, to be honest with you, I haven't really bought, obviously goals do help, but we've been playing one in the hole and whatever, and I haven't been happy with it, you know. Like, work rate ain't, like, fantastic. We went to Soham last Saturday, won 1-0, we got away with it, didn't play well, and When you ain't playing well, you need to graft, in my eyes, and we haven't been doing that. So I thought, well, I'm going to change it up, I'm going to go 2 up front, and, you know, so that's why Tyrus, and to be honest, one thing he does work, his work rate, and I wanted people to...
unfortunately, he got injured, he fell off. I remember getting the ball, the ball got switched across to me, and I've got loads of time, and all I hear is boom, 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 and just see this big guy running at me. He's a great goalie, and he's a player. He's a great goal scorer, and he's on fire. We played against him last year when he was at Thames Meade, and I tell you what, he absolutely annihilated us. And I just said to him before the game, that performance you had against us last year, I expect that every week.
Yeah, well, it just shows, though, obviously, your club itself, how far you've come on, only a couple of months ago, that you did get a bit of a drop. Now, I remember you saying, the 4-0 there was massive. You know, you've come in and you're on a good run yourself, to be fair, when you look for your results. Yeah. You started well. I know we're going to talk about your club in depth in a little while, but, you know, for a draw, which you could have won at the end, say, you know, with your chance, but just goes to show how far you've come on
it's probably the first reason. Well, I can't remember the last time I celebrated a draw. You know, whistle went, there was a little bit... I can't remember.
I was getting a point for a while. So when I look at the league table,
you're like that geezer ticked to you.
Steve knows him.
The league table, you know, you look at the top teams here, like, you know, Maldon, they hammered us away, but we beat them at home.
Yeah.
You know, Brighton Sea, they beat us home, we beat them away. We took a point off of these guys.
Yeah.
We got 4 points off of Averley. You know, so we ain't doing too bad around the teams up the top there. And, you know, if we had won on Saturday, we'd have been in the playoffs.
Yeah.
You know, or people saying, you've played more games. And like I say, I'm more looking at a points tally that I had at the start of the season.
Yeah.
And if we reach that, that's my target. Yeah. And, you know.
But again, you're racking up the points to get nearer to that bunch, you know.
We've got to go we know that. And I won't ever give up on it. You know, I'm ambitious as anyone. And, I want to get in the playoffs. You know, I'm looking. We had a chat on the way here, and I would imagine probably fifth place is probably the only place which is up for grabs at the moment.
Yes.
And there's some good teams going for it, but you know, we ain't going to give up, and we go until it's mathematically impossible.
No, but having said that, going back to that game, without a doubt, the two best teams we've played this season, Morgan and Farrell, footballing wise, I would say.
Yeah. Yeah, far and away. It was a good night. Yeah. And there was more than
so we was more than happy with a point.
Yeah, and fair play to you guys. You did make it hard for us to break you down. And we when we did create, you know, we weren't clinical. And, you know, but like I say, that's football.
Yeah, well, I think the boy had the five had a free header in the first half.
Yeah,
He didn't. He had loads of time, and
obviously the keeper made a great save. Yeah, he made a good.
I think you started really lively, and I think we maybe gave you a little bit too much respect first 15 minutes, and we stood off you. And if we had carried on like that, it would have.
Well, I remember the second half. There was someone around me and Jordan in the midfield quite a bit. I think the black boy, the 12, dropped in a little bit.
Yeah.
To get round us, you know.
We asked him to go in, like I said, like, you know, when we lose possession, you might have to just go in and sit on the holding midfielder and help us out, you know.
Well, I just had a message from Dan Richardson, who was the referee that we was going to be coming in a few weeks and ref the game between Wake Wakering and Dereham. He said, Dereham, a good young side on Saturday, clinical in front of goal, surprised that they're not higher up in the league. I did ask him on his thoughts on Nick, and he said, yes, helped us out, did really well. So,
well done, Nick.
So there we go on then. Romford 1, VCD 0. Mackenzie?
What?
Just get that one to go on?
No, listen, we talk about it. Just things ain't going for us at the moment. We're going through a bit of a rut. We've had to make a few changes after losing Jamie and Chris Newby in the week. But we started really well. We should have been 3-0 up in 10 minutes. We had 3 1-on-1s. Missed them. We're talking about linesmen, but we had an appalling one on Saturday. And I mean appalling. The club's letting have it a little bit in the report as well. But the goal was offside. But 2 minutes after he scored, it's even the worst offside decision I've seen for many a time, where he's about 15 yards offside and the liner's not even looking. And he's only let you run it off the pitch. And obviously I was going a little bit mad and the ref come and apologised.
Apologise for that.
Yeah, and he had a word with him at half time as well, but it didn't get any better. And I was talking to another referee when I come and watched the game on Wednesday, and he was just explaining a little bit about the linesman's not like it used to be, whereas they referee the league below and then lines, they're dedicated linesmen now, and this one was rubbish. I can't say anything nice about it. It was rubbish. The referee himself had a decent game. And we lost. So, second half, it was a bit of a non-event. Both sides gave the ball away so much. I think we just getting more frustrated and frustrated. We didn't score, and confidence is low a little bit. And like I said, we can't buy one at the moment. But we need to get one Saturday, or I'm going to get a load of stick from our lads at Whittam. So, but
we'll that Chinado, fair play to him. How many goals is that now?
Yeah, it's another goal. It's another goal. We didn't do much all game. And like I said, he's gone through. Clear and he's just slotted it, and Joe Bruce played him really well, to be fair. But listen, fair play to Romford. We keep saying this about them. They had a few bodies out as well, to be honest. And they've come in and
they just work hard. They never give up.
No, they're not.
Dan Richardson says they can't all be like him.
No, Dan, they most probably can't, mate. They mostly can't. Well, this one definitely can't. He couldn't tie his shoelaces.
But I'll run for the surprise package every year.
I think they're not
the surprise package anymore because
we played them over the Christmas period, and we had two fantastic results either side, VCD and Thamesmead, and I was expecting to win would have been the Romford one, and we end up losing that, and we did miss a lot of chances on the day, but obviously Chinado scored three goals.
Which he was happy because obviously he played for us for a little bit.
He played for us and his goal scoring record for us wasn't very good.
They're a team, and I watched them play on Wednesday against Thamesmead, and they deserve to beat Thamesmead. Mm. They first half especially, they're very quick on the break, but they're a team that concede a lot of goals because you can get out.
We created
chances because the way they play, they go forward a lot, and it brings us you try and say they're off, not that when you mentioned the off the cuff thing. But it's not, disrespectful. They're a good side, but their response is, their ethic is to score goals and go forward. And Whittam are very similar. And we talk about, they want to score. They've got them players that just go forward, and you can catch them on the break. But if you lose the ball, they've got a lot of players that can only go in that way.
The boy who played up front with
Reynolds. He didn't play Reynolds.
He's been around, isn't he? His mobility ain't going to be great. But I tell you what, put a ball in. You ain't getting a ball.
When I played them, I was quite surprised how good they were. No disrespect to them, I didn't think they would be as good as what they were, and they gave us a really good game.
Well, do you think we speak about this as well, where he come from us, and he ain't stopped scoring. Greg's an handful in his day, but do you think we spoke about money in that many a time? Do you think, because you know they say they don't play in that, do you think there was just no pressure on them, and they just go and play? As individuals, or do you think they're sitting there and their team talk is, well, you're playing against a side that pay this or him, and get out there and they got a point to prove, you know? Because I was talking to a couple of supporters after the game, and I think they said when they lost a couple of weeks ago, they still go and clap them, and someone's going, why are you clapping them for?
They
go and play, and they've done it when they beat us, you know, we're in the middle, we're gutted, and they're off and they're getting clapped off the pitch. So I'm just thinking, you know, is it that they've got not much pressure and they think, do you know what, we should be losing against these sides, and if we beat them, happy days.
Yeah. Could be. Or do we believe they don't play? That's the other thing. I mean, you've got to believe what they say.
Yeah.
But I would say, like that, Chinedu, I mean, I imagine he's on a lot of people's radars at the moment if they're looking at...
That's the thing, if they're not getting that money, it's a shot window from every week to maybe...
Well, yeah, if I play well, you know, someone might come in or me or...
Chinese club, 800 grand a week, and off he goes.
Well, yeah, it'd be nice.
we've had a message.
Vietnam, if that results.
We're talking about that. I've had a tweet coming from Joey Power.
Right.
Yeah, it says, feel sorry for Keith, but I know he will get out of this. I won't say what the word he used. If he can get some of his ball to give him a bit of encouragement, he will get the job done. Never underestimate the power of a pat on the back.
Who's John?
Don't know. Well, it's nice
Joey
of him.
Joe Powell, yeah, sure. Could be.
Boy, yeah. Well, fair enough. Yeah, I think everyone needs a little bit of encouragement when you're struggling. Players do. You know, and Steve would be the same. When you're going through it, you pull your hair out.
We our second half of the season last year, we didn't win a game at home. From Christmas onwards, we didn't win a game at home. And I've never had that as a manager. Normally, leagues and whatever, last season, from Christmas to the end of the season, is pulling the air out.
I think he's going to do us, I must admit.
It does test you, and I won't lie, you know, you can't sit there, you know, you've got to be fixed in to be a manager. Now, I've known Steve for a long time, and, you know, and you are getting criticism from people, and you've just got to take it on the chin. When you're winning, it's easy, you get on with it, but you just can't stop believing what you're doing. You know, for all the grief or stick that I might get, some of it can be well deserved, who knows, but it still won't stop me working as hard as I am and doing what I'm doing. And, you know, just because I'm up here every week doesn't mean that I'm just larding it up every single day. You know, Ben see me in the week and Steve does his job, and mine will be the same, and you just hope you're going to come through it, and then things start going your way. At the moment, we're getting no luck, we're getting nothing going our way, and we're losing, and we just need to push
We spoke about it off air before, but the tweet I think you put out during the beginning of the last week, and the response you got from, and I don't know what the gentleman's name was, and I can't remember top of my head, and we spoke about it, and I was just reading it, and just reading the, you know, reading the stuff that the guy was putting on there, it was just unbelievable, you know, attack, you know, and you're just thinking to yourself, well, hang on a minute, you know,
to be honest with you, you're 100% right, I know fully well, and sorry, but... You know,
he's one of the hardest working managers in the game.
He had long enough at VCD. Mm. He never won a promotion from the Kent League to the Ryman League. So I think he's talking rubbish, to be honest with you. I will back keep up on that. I don't think he won many fans with that, really.
No.
From our point of view, obviously there's a real close relationship between our two clubs, and there's a lot of bar bragging rights, and obviously at the moment we're winning those hands down, but Keith's one of our mates, and we all see the hours he puts in off the pitch, and we talk to him a lot, and how much he's going in, and we feel for him, because obviously first result we look at is how they're doing it, and it is obviously in the bar there's a little bit of banter that goes on between friends, but we feel for him because it is tough. But as I say, you know, as all teams, when you're down there and you're nothing's going your way, just need something.
You just believe you can get a result. And, you know, we've got 15 games left, and you're looking at them, and on paper, our running isn't bad. Obviously, we've got a couple of toughies coming up. You know, Witten's going to be difficult for us on Saturday, because I know we have a bit of laugh and a joke about them, but they're a decent side. And then we've got Bowers and Elmchurch. on the spin. Now, I'm pretty passing to beat Bowen. I don't know how, but it happens. And then you look at your running, you think, well, that ain't too sad. But you can, at this level of football, we've been saying, from the teams at the bottom to the teams at the top, everyone can beat everyone, but you just need something to go your way. You know, I need Nick Robinson to come and do our line. At the moment, I need him to do the middle.
I've just had this come back in from the Joe Powers account. It says, Dave, it's John. I won't say the word again, idea how these things work. So I'm using my son's system, but it's my fault, not Joe's.
Johnny Power.
I just also to say as well, we're talking about hard working managers in the game. Probably one of the others, present company excluded, but one of the other guys who we spoke about last week as well, who's probably one of my. If you've got a favourite manager in the game, he's Mark Morsey, and welcome, Mark, he's just joined us as well. Because I think what a fantastic job
he's done. Unbelievable job. And again, yeah, he's been around, and you know, he'd mostly come on the radio soon and let us know how well. But from last year to this year, what I was saying about football, and his sides, particularly, nearly the same.
Yeah.
So he's done a great job.
So moving on then, so Sandown Rangers 2, Brighton Sea Regent 2.
That's a shock for me. Right? I know you, Steve, yeah. Two bit more. They went up to Soham, which is difficult. Yeah. But you know, Brighton East Sea for me are a strong side, and
good side.
You know, I think the point helps yourselves out with the point, and the other, and obviously with Bowers as well. It's only Morden that's won. But you know, again, they must have thought they won it. Soham scored in the 85th, and then obviously,
Brighton East Sea before the game looking at 3 points and. You know, for me, I think the title's going to Thurrock, Morden, Brighton Sea. I think they're going to be the three up.
Yeah, oh, definitely. Yeah.
And I think they've got to be looking at that result, you know, are we get a win here today. Yeah. But, you know, we played them last week and they battered us. Mm. You know,
we were
really bad. I weren't, you know, like say, it was a long coach journey home and all that. And it was. It weren't celebrated as a win, really, was it? Because we were poor.
We were totally, yeah. Apart from our goalkeeper's
had the game of his life.
Yeah.
And
I'm not having your coach trip on the way home weren't like a win. I'm not having that.
Yeah, of course,
it
was
not
the atmosphere.
Because
I said, I don't think they deserve it. But what I would say is, our goalkeeper was unbelievable. He's never ever game like it. He's saved 3 1-on-1s in the first half. He's made a double save in the second half. Then he saved the penalty. I mean, he couldn't have done anything better.
We went down to 10 men. McMahon sent off, down to 10 men, and then we get a penalty and score it. But
Salem, they were saying exactly the same. I think the week before they played Norwich, and they'd lost 2-1, they was in front. They just said that, and obviously they've taken their chances there, because they play some good football and they create a lot of chances.
Yeah. Well, the player manager, he's an handful. Mason's an handful.
He didn't play.
Yeah,
always. He didn't play. No, they were saying. Yeah, they did say that they needed him on there, to be honest, to take some of those chances. But no.
it was a good 3 points. And like I say, Brighton stay at home. They've got a point out of it. I think it's a good point for them, isn't it?
Well, it is.
It's a good point, but when you're 2-0 up, it's not.
No.
You ain't gonna be happy, are you? Really?
Tends to be Neil Chesham 5.
Well, it's a shock. It's a shock. It isn't a shock for performance what I see on the Wednesday, but obviously Thamesmead are on a great run, and Chesham, like us, and I was talking to Paul on the phone the other week, have been going through it as well with their team, and it just goes to show when that boy scores goals, they're a completely different side. And he popped up with another hat trick.
Yeah.
Liam Oates scored, and so did Emmanuel Roussi. So all these forwards are banged goals, and. When you've got that strike power, as we've said, and I think the lads were talking about it last week.
Saturday.
You can win games, but they're not downside, you know. And yeah, but I wouldn't put it past you to go and get a result easily there.
He's a good player. He's a good player.
If you look after him, but I'm surprised, because especially size of Jason as well, with Thamesmead's size and physical ability, you know, I thought they would have dealt with Chesham. Not, don't mean beat them, but you know, I know a couple of goals were late on, but 5-0 at home.
It's a poor result.
Especially the one they've been on.
They've been playing well. Like they was when we played them with Boxing Day.
Yeah.
They was on a 6-game win. They won 6 on a spin or something.
Spin, yeah.
You know, and we went and we played well on the day, and
but they had chances.
Our goal, like Stevie Phillips as well, in there's pulled off like the save. You're not going to believe.
Yeah, you better go quick yarn about him.
No. He's been through a broken.
Yeah, he needs to be.
Tilbury 1, Haringey Borough 1.
Surprise for me, I thought Tilbury would have won that. Mm. And not because I know Hammond go up and down, but just it's at Tilbury, and obviously, you know, it's a difficult place to go.
The weather out, it's been again, yeah, quite a bit boggy.
Harringay with a much better side.
So we backed them twice.
Yeah, Harringay with a much better side on Saturday.
They were a good side. They were a good side. Mm-hmm. And they've gone 1-0 up again. And
I know the goalkeeping coach at Tilbury, works a couple of shots down from me at the market, and he said that they was a much better side and they got away with it, really, Tilbury. Well, 1-0, that don't really help. Tilbury needed to win that, really.
Yeah, well, you know, they were a side that we were talking about just before we played them over the Christmas period, before we broke for the Christmas, and saying that they're right outside. I think Craig was saying from the league vice chairman that he thought they had the best record against the top six sides in the league. We played them a Boxing Day and beat them comfortably, to be fair.
Yeah.
And then they've gone up and down a little bit since. And if you look, they haven't got a bad side. There's a couple of lads that I quite liked in there, but Harringay a free, you know, scoring side, didn't they?
We played them at home and they bullied us, really. Big, strong. We couldn't live with them on the night. They gave it 3-0, weren't it? Mm. That was 3-0.
Oh, yeah.
And
he was never in it.
Never in it.
Waltham Abbey 1, Morden and Chiptree 4.
It's their own goals, wasn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it's not a surprise. But
he's got to go and put the third one in for an hat trick, isn't it?
What do you get?
Give it up. Hang him up.
Yeah.
You get a ball
stuck up your backside. Not like. You know, I'll put 7 days in to play him up front.
I know Spencer, so he'd probably have it at all.
As I said, when your luck's going your way, it's going your way. And it's the first goal, isn't it? And it's a big thing. It's Waltham Abbey, again, another difficult place to go. Morden's away record isn't the best. No. They'll tell you that their home record is unbelievable. But it's a great weekend for Morden.
When you're up there and you're challenging for the title and all that, that's the first thing you do. Like when you walk in, you check your boys around you, what they're doing. Mm. They've walked in and gone, oh, what a great
day. Happy
days,
yeah.
Witham 1, AFC Hornchurch 5.
Now this is a shock for me, right? Yeah. Not
and me as well.
Not that Hornchurch won, okay, because Hornchurch won a good run, and I thought their physicalness and that, but I thought the pace and that of Witham at home would cause a few more problems. Obviously, we spoke to Smalls and that about Bowers, and you know they beat them, obviously, yourselves.
Yeah.
You know, they've got a lot of attacking flair, and I thought their pace might have caused Hornchurch some problems. But, McKenzie's popped up another hat trick, and he's just found his goal scoring. But it must be that name this year, because both of them...
Both about 25 each, I think.
Just scored goals, and before, both of them... Wouldn't be in this situation. Yeah, so
and he weren't getting in a side at the start of the season.
No,
was he
isn't.
Was, I think what he had in front of him, he had
David Knight,
Purcell, Freeman.
There
was four of them up there, and
he's always got in positions.
He's a good position. He's so strong. Balls in the box, he's going to cause you problems. Yeah. And I think that's probably where a lot of his goals are coming.
Yeah,
crosses and whatever.
You know, him and Ross wore an handful, and that might have been the only thing. If they'd gone a little bit more direct, you know, the way Hornchurch play a little bit, on that pitch at Witham, that could have been the one that's
is Purcell still not playing?
No.
How long's he out for?
He's not really, I think he was coming back from another scan, I think. I don't know how long he's been coming back
in pre-season.
Well, we got him in a fortnight, so it's not even been a bad.
We've got him coming up, yeah.
Yeah, you know, but... It's another win. It keeps them in that.
Yeah, it's
pack,
one of them.
You know?
I mean, we said it ages ago, in that eighth or ninth. You go, don't ever rule them out because
they're going to run. Yeah,
we even looked at it.
It's a surprise that they were down. I always thought where they were.
And you know, no one's going to want to play them in the playoffs if they get there.
I think they'll stay there. They're staying in the playoffs. Yeah. So they're probably just. they were improved. Like you know, the running now.
Yeah.
Experience, they know.
Well, that's what they're going to have. The pitches, the way they play.
Yeah, I think they cement their place in there. And I said to you previously, I think that fifth place is probably the last one up for grabs.
I was just looking at the, and I'm one of these ones for this, but for the attendances when you look down it, and the highest attendance in the norm was 125.
I was
going to talk
about this earlier, yeah.
And the lowest attendance was 58 in the league.
Mm.
Poor. I mean, from our point of view, I can only speak from our point of view. We bang on to the, you know, as much as we can in our area and the club we've got, and the, you know, the teams, the junior teams, trying to encourage people to come down. But I don't know, you're heads against a bit of a brick wall at times, and I think all these clubs are going with it. I think a lot of the time as well, you've got to take the cost of it. It's not cheap to go and watch non-league. Yeah. The time of year, I think January as well, a lot of the dads that will come down this dry January, people talk about that, they're not going to come down because they might be thinking about having a beer or whatever. And January, obviously, money's a little bit, people are, you know, generally paying for Christmas and stuff. So I think it all comes into it. But you look around, every club, apart from some of the bigger town clubs like yourselves here, and I think Bury, who are in our league, get decent crowds. I think we're all trying ways of encouraging people to come down.
It is a shame.
But it is a shame.
Like, you know, I'll be totally honest with you, I'm getting bored of them. I'm getting bored of watching Premier League football and all that. I'd rather go and watch it on the game, you know, on this football. And
it's weird though, because we'll go through in a minute, but if you look at the South, their gates
decent,
double, treble than what the North is. It's, you know, and we know they have got some bigger clubs in there. As well, this year with the North, there's a lot of clubs on top of each other. You know, there are a lot of local derbies. Look at the three next to us, and yourself. You know, it took me 10 minutes to get to, you know, it was quicker to get a Thurrock on Saturday than get a Thames meeting. Yeah. We went straight through the tunnel. Boswell was there.
The lowest crowd on Saturday in the South was probably, in my opinion, the biggest game of the day, which was Cray against Corinthian Casuals, which was 186. Mm. That's the lowest crowd. That's the lowest crowd, 186. The highest crowd was at Lewis, and they got 500.
Lewis do get that anyway.
I mean, the other thing from our point of view, it was Cheltenham, was it, or Millwall Cheltenham? I can't remember which way around. That was on Saturday, so that takes, you know, people maybe, but it is noticeable. It is so hard. I mean, I know that VCD are exactly the same as us, but it's a headache.
Well, basically, I mean, you know, you're talking about the South and the figures they get. I mean, even in the Prem, the lowest crowd, the Falcon crowds are not in the paper, but the lowest one on here is Met Police, 112. The highest is Habit and Waterlooville at 562. So if you look at that, there's not much difference really between them and Lewis.
No, but Lewis are difficult. You know, they've always been a big club. Average 400 or 500. You know, they're all, you know, think about it. They've just got Brighton, and, you know, I know Worthing's not too far away, and they was at home in the trophy as well, weren't they? But you know, they've always attracted a lot of people down to Lewis. So.
But do you not think they should, with those crowds, they should be doing better?
They're a club owned, aren't they? So all their money comes through that, you know. So
they had a poor season last year. We knocked them out of the FA Cup last year, didn't they? That was terrible.
No, they were, and they're just outside the playoffs.
I'm just going to sum up the attendances in the trophy. Sudbury got 505. Of course, they were at home here. We got 816 here, and Worthing got 1,398 at Worthing. So, John's just tweeted back. Says, "Dave, I have to be honest. I've never known Boyle so controlled and calm around anything football. Would he consider transferring that side of him to Saturday afternoon? Certainly give our ears a rest."
I don't know.
Surely
that's not an alias for someone else.
Anyway, Ryman South then. Carl Shulton Athletics 6, Chatham Town 1, 2-2-3 there. Bradford getting 4, 22-45-74-79.
Well, Chatham are playing tonight. It's 0-0 at the moment. But
they're struggling, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. And we both know Piggy well, and he was in a bit of a, you know, it was an hard job to go in. Cole Shorten are a decent side as well, so, and that's on the plastic as well, wasn't it? So
I look at his lineup, and I was expecting a few more boys to follow him over, you know, and they ain't really.
What happened. Can he offer them though? That's the thing, you know. Chatham, I wouldn't say they haven't got anybody, but you know, you're a side that's struggling.
They brought the boy Mitchelson, who was at Ashford, who's come in. I always thought he was a decent player. I don't know. I don't know what he can. You know, like I say, what was he offering him at Hollands and Blair?
Yeah.
Apparently he didn't have a wage bill at Hollands and Blair, so they were paying for him there for no money. Mm. You know, if he's offering him a little bit of pocket money, maybe they would have come over. Yeah. But I look at their lineup, and he needs to get a few of them in, I think. Yeah. You know, because they had that
they're right tight,
yeah, they're right tight knit group there, and
Oh, he's done well there.
We've said the last couple of weeks, you know, that they've been in that league a couple of years and they were dying to get back in it, and it could be their downfall.
Yeah.
Well, I think they could go down.
Well, their record's not great. They're obviously a big game tonight, home at that derby against Faversham. Yeah. They need to get something.
Mm. Yeah, and like six goals as well, which conceding six ain't great, is it?
No.
Because 83 so far from 29 games.
Yeah. But they're glad God on me.
Cricket Casuals 1, Cray Wanderers 1.
It's not a shock because both of them up there.
Cray had 10 men.
Yeah, Danny Ainge got sent off. That's going to be a blow to them.
Yeah, so
that's the only one who's been scoring.
They've just signed a new four, but that's going to be a blow to them with that. You know, Corinthians.
Do you know what's up when he got sent off? Because if he got sent off early doors, that's a good point.
Yeah, it's a good point. I'd say that, you know, they're 1-0 up and, well, couldn't have been from the pen because they equalised 1-1 a couple of minutes later. Yeah. But, you know, with 10 men, I think they'd be happy with a point there.
Yeah. Horsham 2, Dorking Wanderers 0.
What a result, yeah, that is. That's one of the result of the week, isn't it? You know, for Dorking are flying. Yeah, I think so. And with, you know, they had a player sent off as well as sent off at Dorking, so again, we're not too sure when that was.
They've had a kind of dodgy results of like that as well.
Yeah, they have. Every time we keep saying how well they're doing.
We've got the markers on them. Hivetown 6, Walton Casuals 1.
It's a surprise because.
They've been
getting hammered. I know J-May scored, he come back in, didn't he? And he scored.
But according to this, there was 3 goals in the 90th minute. So, yeah. As well there.
Yeah. 2 from the same.
Oh, yeah.
That's it. You know, well, 4 goals in the last 9 minutes.
Yeah.
Did he score that Dean Grant? Has he gone? He's gone there, hasn't he? Did he
May, score? Cloak, Adam, and Pogue.
Right. Mm. Well, no, that, to be fair, that's a great result for them because they have. They've been having a bit of a tough time, haven't they?
Yeah.
Lewis 3, Herne Bay 1.
No, it's not a shock. We keep saying Herne Bay are struggling and they need them. They're another team that needs them. You know, we know them from our neck of the woods as Chatham, and they're another team that needs some points desperately.
You know, they've been in that division a long time, quite a few years now. And, you know, one thing you do when you do establish yourself as a Ryman club, you don't want to be going back down to the Kent League.
No. But their 2 centre forwards, so much experience of Ian Pullman and Mark Lovell.
Yeah.
You know, and you just sit there and think, oh, they do need goals.
I'm looking at the league table and, you know, Chatham on 21 and Herne Bay on 32. That's a big gap.
Yeah, it was good.
I can't see them pulling that around. I think I'd say Herne Bay get a few more wins and they're safe.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
As a, I suppose, The one result on here, and well, it wasn't a result because it was postponed, but the game that must be a real kick in the teeth for them, it must be, when you look at Guernsey, I think they're having a game called off against Sittingbourne, which then means they've got to go to Sittingbourne.
But they had to call it off the day before because of the flights.
It must be one of those things, when they get a Saturday game called off, it must be an absolute killer for them, especially if they're away. Because it means another game that I've got to try and get fit in on a Tuesday night.
Yeah, we had them at Lewis in FA Cup replay last year. And that flying night on a.
That's part of what they want to do, though. So, they haven't got many.
But their flight was delayed at Gatwick, do you remember? They said, it got delayed. And
turned up about 45 minutes before kickoff.
And I was in the Isle of Wight. I said, well, I had to come back from the Isle of Wight. I said, no, I can't be delayed. I've got to go back. So, but, no, you know, they're. They look like they're in trouble, Guernsey, don't they?
Yeah,
you know, the boy up top,
he's not there anymore. He's
gone travelling, is he?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, they are in a bit of trouble.
They play so much football.
Mm.
It was, you know, honestly, we beat them in a replay, and we've got 2 early goals. They just
the only thing is, obviously, the 3 teams below them are struggling. Yeah. You know, Chatham aren't far on points, but they're on a bad run and. You know,
they've got a couple of games in hand, but I'd rather have the points on the board than games in hand when you're in that sort of situation because, you know, that's what it's all about, you know, because you're playing games and you ain't winning, you know.
Yeah.
Tooting Richmond United 5, East Grinstead 2.
It's not a shock, Tooting are flying, but I tell you what, that poor keeper, he ain't done anything. He's been conceding goals for fun since he's coming here, young
five
Chris.
5 or 4 or 6
He's coming here saying that what he's done, and he's like.
Oh, he came on the show, did he?
Yeah. I told you not to his name, he's hands in the door on the
way. Cursed him, we cursed him. Yeah.
Sat in here and like, telling us about his pro career when he was 19.
Yeah.
And he's been absolute, they've been conceding for fun, but Tooting, listen, yeah, they're decent, aren't they? And it's not a shock.
They went top as well, didn't they?
Yeah.
Well, no, they were top beforehand, weren't they?
Yeah. Top of the league. It's not a shock that they won that.
They're East Greens did the sort of always around about Dan and Bottom anyway, aren't they?
Yeah. So looking at the run on Division 1 South then, it's Tooting and Mitcham United at the top, played 30 with 65, Dalkin and X played 29 with 61, Greenwich Borough played 29 with 59, and Gary Alexander and the boys will be with us this time next week. Hive Town 29 with 55, Lewis have played 29 with 54, Corinthian Casuals 28 with 53, just slipped outside this week. Carshawn Athletic have played 30 with 52, and Walton Casuals have played 31 with 50. And at the bottom, Godalming didn't play this week, but they played 29 with 9 points. Three Bridges played 27 with 18, Chatham have played 29 with 20. Then there's the gap, Guernsey 28 with 25, Moseley 28 with 27, Ramsgate 28 with 29, and East Grinstead 29 with 30. In the Division 1 North, then it's Morland Tiptree played 31 with 66. 6 point gap to Thurrock in second with 31 with 60. Brighton City played 28 with 56. Hornchurch played 31 with 56. Bowers and Pitsey played 30 with 51. Chessant 31 with 51. And then we've got Bury, Averley and Phoenix all on 50. Tilbury on 48. Haringey Borough 47. I mean, it goes that far down, doesn't it, really?
It's tight all over.
The bottom, Wroxham 29 with 19. Great Wakering 31 with 22. Brentwood Town 30 with 24. Then a 6 point gap to Waltham Abbey 31 with 30. Heybridge 29 with 32. Weir 29 32. Soham 30 with 34. In the Rhyme of Prem, it's Bob Norregis atop, played 27 with 54. Needham have played 28 with 53. Havant Waterlooville played 26 with 52. Leeston have played 24 with 48. Dulwich Hamlet have played 29 with 46. And we've got Enfield Town and Tonbridge just outside on 44. And at the bottom, we've got Grays Athletic have played 30 with 23. Then a 4 point gap to Canby Island, Hendon, and Merstham all on 27. Burgess Hill Town on 28. Met Police, Harrow Borough. Are both on 30. So, I mean, the teams that are in the bottom, so we start with the Prem first, I mean, any escapees there?
Listen, yeah, you know, when you look at Endon and things like that, their experience has always got on that, and Gales, you know, he's a top manager, and I think, as we said, I think they will be one.
Mersham had a great FA Cup run, didn't they?
Yeah, that's the one with the Mersham, isn't it? They have had a great FA Cup run, and
what do you choose? You get relegated, you have the FA Cup run.
They need to stay in the league.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
They need to
must have earned some money from that as well.
They've got games in hand, as I know you said. But that league, as every single season, it goes to the wild where someone puts a 5-winning run, bosh, they're clear. Or it goes the other way. Yeah. It's a team that's normally 13th and 14th that just don't win a game and they slip right down and they're
clear. You're looking at that, that is
well, from Wingate down, it's 9 points. I mean,
it's 3 games.
Yeah. You'd be looking up, if you use Wingate down, you'd be looking over your shoulder, wouldn't you?
Well, Dan's just tweeted again. He said he's reffing at Met Police versus Billericay tomorrow night. Thoughts?
Of course. Take your earmuffs if Craig's on the line.
it's on paper. You would say Billericay, but I tell you what, I'll go. If I was a betting man, I'd go a draw.
We never seem to do well over there when we went over there when I played for them. Never. I don't think. No. I think we might have won.
Nice place.
Once.
Is that because of the place?
Yeah, a few of our boys were a bit looking over their shoulder.
But I think every week everyone's expecting. It's going to click. Billericay's going to click, and they're going to go on a massive winning spree. But it hasn't happened yet, has it?
No.
So it'll be interesting. So we've written a draw around the town.
No, I'd go Billericay.
Oh yeah, I'm going away with.
Yeah.
They need it because if they lose, then Met Police.
Met Police had a good win, didn't they, the weekend?
Yeah, they're
home. I think Met Police could definitely get something.
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah, definitely. Then we look into the north. Then, so I mean. 6 points the gap at the bottom. Anybody going to get out of there?
It's difficult. When you look at it, and you don't like, especially in your own league, say who's going to go down or whatever, but, you know, 6 points if you're not winning any games. I know Lamar's back. Their game's was called
good
off.
Good player.
They're playing, they've got Romford tomorrow night, if it's on, and that's a big game.
See, they beat us comfortably at home, and... I thought I was going to, you know, be
able to. Again, we talk, I spoke about the Whittams and what they've got a lot of pace in this.
Boy out, Wyatt Freeman.
Brentwood will get out of that.
They had a boy up top as well early on in the season, and he was a pest. LDR.
I think out of the three, out of the three, they're the ones that I think will get out of it. But you look above, and I can't see
Great Wakering, like, you know.
I can't see who would be the ones that slip into it, to be honest. Because where with Anwar, Anwar's going to get them winning games.
And that's a big gap from Wroxham to Waltham Abbey, isn't it? You've got a promotion for it, really, haven't you?
Yeah. You know, Great Wakering, I know they signed guys in, whatever, but, you know, they play a game more than Brentwood. It's Waltham Abbey, you would say, could, but then.
But I see that they pick up the odd win here and there, don't they? So I watched Brentwood play the other week, and I've got to be honest, when we beat them at our place, they still give us a decent game, but they didn't look too, full of confidence.
We played Brentwood first game of the season, beat them 3-0 away. Weren't really a 3-0, to be honest with you.
What's the magic number? Which, you know, Premier League took about 40 points. What's the magic number at 50? Is that the magic number you're looking at?
Well, we're all right then.
Yeah, toilet break.
It's coming.
I don't.
Listen,
I'll be less than that.
Yeah.
I reckon probably 44.
Something
maybe.
Like that, yeah. I'd have to have a look at what was it last year. I always judge what went down last year and sort of go with that. You know?
I mean, do you judge it as managers though, when you look at that and players? Sort of relegation spot. Do you look at the third relegation spot as being relegated, or do you?
It's been the last few years.
You look at the bottom two.
If you get relegated, you've got an R next to your name. I don't care if you get a reprieve or not. Relegation is relegation.
You've got to wait.
I mean, Brentwood. If they were to back to back.
Yeah.
That'd be shocking for them.
I've seen them this season. I must admit, I thought they were poor. And I mean, they're playing Wroxham at the time, and Wroxham were even worse on that occasion. But it was a case with Wroxham; it was almost a case of they looked pretty decent, you know, going up to up to the midfield, and then there was just no one.
My only concern with them,
you know, that was the problem.
My only concern with them is bad weather and their pitch. If they get a lot of cancellations, say they lose tomorrow night's game, and then and they're falling behind and points, and then they've got a last minute rush, that would be the only way for them.
But then on the flip side, we played them twice when I went back to Billericay last year, once at home and obviously once away. The pitches were poor both games. They got points against us.
If they've got a lot of games to play,
to catch up,
bit of pressure, bit of that.
We played them first game of the season, and he hadn't had a drop of water on it. It was like a meadow.
It was baked, absolutely.
Couldn't believe it.
Well, I was over there just for Christmas watching against Heybridge, and the pitch was clogging up. That's without any real rain, and obviously it's called off Friday for Saturday's game. And that's the only thing, you know, like Keith said, the catch-up might be too much. Been in that situation.
So in Environment North then, if we was to say one of those teams gets out, who's going to be the one that's going to drop in?
I think... You look at it now, don't you, and you go, well...
BCD.
I think Wolf...
What am I laughing?
They're all right. I think they pick up points.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I look at that and I think, I can't see no one.
Are Brentwood going to get more points than Waltham Abbey towards the end of the season? I'm not sure.
They've got to win two games, haven't they?
Yeah.
Three if you look at their goal record. So just to get above Waltham Abbey, it's, you know.
And Waltham Abbey had that experience of it last year as well. There was a relegation fight last year, got out of it, and I think they got Asa Belonga this year, have they?
That's also a thing.
And he scored a lot of goals for them last year.
It's going to be a tough.
You know, you got Weir in 19th, and
but anyone can put
them.
They're not.
I mean, do you think they're finding it hard as well? You know, not in it last year, then back in it again this year. They seem to get moved about.
Speaking to their committee, I think they would like to go back into the
south,
south of the league I was in last year. I don't think they're particularly, not saying I don't like the Roman League, but I think that would suit them better, yeah, definitely.
Because they seemed to do quite well in that league last year, didn't they?
No, they've done okay. They lost a few players as well, though, haven't they?
They're decent going forward.
Yeah, they are.
Good
going
forward.
No, they are.
Of course, they lost the likes of Kieran Bishop, who's now at Rays and people like that as well. So that's going to be losing some of his ability, I suppose, in your team is going to cause you a few.
That's what we played them twice, beat them twice, but it weren't cut and dry in either of them.
We were 2-0 up in the 88th minute and drew 2-1.
Shocking, yeah.
And he'll get players, Anwar, because obviously he's got a lot of connections. I think he works for the FA
The new manager's gone in, he's gone the other fella, hasn't he?
Yeah, so he will get a lot of players in, or he'll have, you know, have the opportunity to. And you know, I can't see them dropping.
No, I can't either. Mm. You know, I think they've got a little bit too much.
They've got a bit of firepower as well, haven't they?
Boy out on the right. Scores goals as well. Good player.
Yeah, he's good.
Well, we're going to go for a little comfort break. We'll be back in 5 minutes. So please make sure you join us back here on Facebook Live in probably about 5 minutes' time. And we will start discussing Phoenix Sports. We'll try and discuss as well the Rahman sponsorship. Mm. And we'll also, I think if Keith was there and if Andy was there, we'll talk about what I think the drop down in the, if we're allowed to, of course, in the meeting that the Secretary's meeting as well, with the Rahman League as well. But we'll do all that in probably about 5 minutes' time. So please join us. Join us then. I say we're all going to go for a comfort break and then we'll be back in 5 minutes' time.
What's that? Youngsters.
And we're back.
We're live again.
And we're back with the Rahman Lads for the second half. Shall we just quickly go through then this? I suppose the end of an era, I suppose, because of.
My future's got a text that I ain't got.
No.
Oh, right.
Not yet. Just check. But no, I mean, end of an era, you know, with the Rahman League no longer being with us. I mean, thoughts on that? I mean.
Yeah, I think it's obviously sad.
Yeah.
When you say what team do you manage or play for, you go to Rahman League and everybody knows. You know, it's they've been excellent sponsors for the 20 odd years they've done it, it is an end of an era, and I would say it's difficult to see where the league, you know, it's always going to go forward, but it's going to be weird, you know, because you can go back to the old Dr. Martins or whatever it was years and years and years ago, but you know you do.
They've been been a fantastic sponsor, but obviously we're new to the league, second season. But that meeting at the beginning of the season, to me, that the writing was on the wall. They had one of the chief execs or one of the top guys from Rahman there who was pushing to every club, and it was sort of not an embarrassment for the league, but the fact that all the teams that were representing, not many of them spent much money with the company, and they're obviously putting their money where their mouths are by sponsoring the league, and they obviously felt they wasn't getting a lot back for their money. So business wise, I can understand it, because and they were really trying to push all the clubs to try and bring some revenue in from every club's got businessmen involved in there, and try and push the Rahman brand within the within the clubs. And obviously, unfortunately, I would say that obviously hasn't worked for them. So.
It's going to seem really strange, isn't it? Just because, you know, you look on the, everything you look at, you just look for that big red sign on your board, ground.
Or get a new kit.
You know.
Or get a new kit.
Or your arm things. You know, it's just what you expect. It's what you're used to.
That's a good point, isn't it? I mean, everybody's got
Everybody's
got the Rahman badges on there. Is that another expense?
No sponsor who comes in ain't going to want that on the arm, is it?
Well, no, obviously they do the stick over ones or whatever it's going to be.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot of people.
A lot of rebranding.
Yeah, it's rebranding, but, you know, you what they've done over the 20 years has been
fantastic.
Phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You know, they've really supported the league as much as the League Cup and the women's youth as well.
Yeah.
It's not just one league they've got to look at now. It's, you know, it's major. The league, you know, the League Cup, they actually prize money for the first time over the last few years. I think, you know, there's one thing that you can't knock Ali for or them is what they've done and the sponsorship and the professionalism of our league compared to the others at a step. It's, you know, it has been put out there and I know, obviously, you know, we talk about Nick and that laughing and joking that, you know, about his linesman thing of the week, but we know that they're going to be working hard to secure the new sponsorship, and it is a big thing. You know, it's big boots to fill.
I would imagine a lot of players that play in the Ryman don't realise it's a stationary shop. They think it's probably
But that is part of, unfortunately, the Ryman. The problem why that maybe that it hasn't worked from on the business side of things to obviously their names out there, but linking the two together and creating the sponsorship into people using them to buy the stationery. I mean,
if the Ryman, if you drive past the Ryman station shop, people go, I play for them, I play.
Yeah.
If it was a sports shop, they would do really well.
Yeah.
Really say,
you're eating something.
No, that was another thing you could open up, but I'm just saying, if it was a sports shop, you go, I'll get all the gear from Ryman, it would be a different thing.
Yeah, no, you're right.
It must be, as I say, they obviously have had discussions, and I'm sure the league, hopefully have got someone to move in place, because it is, as every club knows, or we certainly know, that sponsorship is one of the hardest things to get. Mm. And whether it be from selling one ball round a pitch for whatever you sell it for, but something as major as a whole league, it's big bucks, and I'm hoping that they do have someone. Mm. I mean, if not, we've got a friend of ours.
Well, he's just come on.
Mid-Kent Metal. I mean, the Mid-Kent Metal League, I've said to John, who's one of our major sponsors, that he should put his money where his mouth is and get the Mid-Kent Metal League.
Yeah, why not?
But,
I think you're going to get a tweet pretty soon.
Anyone's
450 grand a season, but yeah. The statement here says, League Chairman Nick Robinson says, as one door closes, another one opens. Mm. But that Ryman and their unwavering support will be greatly missed. It's a sad day, said Nick, who replaced long-serving Alan Turby in 2015, but it is one which we knew would come sooner or later. We are very proud of the work we have done with Ryman and the other companies in the Theo Perfitius Retail Group. Everyone associated with the sponsorship has been so supportive, and the companies have been wonderful to work with over the last 20 years. We've built up a great friendship, and I know these will not be lost in the future. The Ryman League clubs and their fans are also looking forward to benefiting from the new six-figure match balls and benchware sponsorship partnership with leading international sports brand Mitre from the start of 2018 season. Announced last Sunday at the meeting at the Ryman League, 72 clubs, the four-year deal with one-year option has been estimated cash value of approximately £290,000.
Yeah.
As they've said in the thing there, the press release.
John's just said £250,000 a season. Bring it on.
Go on, John.
it's a big thing that's just happened for the league. I think but everything's got to move forward. I think it's pretty clever announcing the Mitre deal. That's a big thing with replacing Macron and Mitre's massive.
They bring their Mitre Delta balls back.
That's
a lovely
ultimate.
To be fair, though, I mean, I don't know. I mean, and fair play to Macron, because that is they've obviously again sponsored league, but from what other players say, I don't. Are you a big fan of the Macron football?
It's the actual footballs.
Yeah. I think Mitre is
better. Yeah, I think everyone's going to look forward to the footballs. I think.
I was in Pro Kit the other day. I used to work in Pro Kit a few years ago, and I'd get all my stuff now and in there. And they said that. The bench where I've seen
it's improved a lot, Mitre.
Not that nothing's concrete, but I've seen all the stuff that's in the shop that they've got, and it is actually not as bad as what people will probably
think.
What,
the Mitre gear?
The Mitre gear.
We've started promoting it within our club, and it's come on a lot.
The bench kit for next year is going to be exceptionally
they
good.
They are trying to...
As long as it's warm.
Well, that's it.
That's what I'm saying. Some of the stuff I've seen is the material is...
They've really pushed it.
Trying to get back into football in a big way, Mike.
Mitre is going to be definitely a plus.
Yeah. And you hope maybe someone might piggyback off the back of that. Yeah. I think, it's going in the right way. Now, the league itself has got a great reputation. Mm,
absolutely.
And also, you might find that, some sort of thought, well, it's an opportunity now that Ryman are gone, because they were there for so long.
Mm, yeah.
Might be a company been trying to get in for years and sit and think, look, if Theo's done it, he might even be able to put his contacts on with someone. Yeah. They know that the league's really well run. Mm.
Someone would definitely jump on it, wouldn't they?
Yeah.
It'd be an opportunity, maybe, that they can't pass by. I mean, the only thing I'm worried about, though, is the Ryman Roundup shows were quite a ring to it, to be fair.
It did, didn't it?
Yeah. Well, it begins with an R.
Yeah. It could be a bit interesting, depending on what the actual sponsorship is.
So what the room is, would be brilliant.
So is there any rumours of who might be?
Nothing that I've been told.
I've heard of Evo Stick.
Yeah, that's what I've heard.
Well, I think that everyone's mentioned Evo Stick because it does the other two leagues in, at the same level under the pyramid, don't they? They do. And if they have a quick complete clean sweep.
And I've heard, if they've got like a sister company or something, someone did mention it to me the other day. What was that? Yeah, no, someone said that they've got a sister company and it might be.
Maybe.
I can't remember what the actual name of it is.
They might brand them.
Yeah.
Well, we've got somebody else who just tweeted, but this gentleman, he's one of the guys who was with Football Exclusives last year and did a fantastic job in Rav and did a great job there, I must admit. And he's put, I think everyone in recent years considers the Isthmian League as the Ryman League. Everyone in the football world still calls the National League the conference. Apart from the sponsorship change, would the guys change anything else within the leagues?
Our league position. No, obviously, I think what's going to happen in 2018-19 is going to be the number of teams. It's going to be sort of changed, lessened. And obviously, then your travelling is going to change as well, I think, in the step. Mm. I think that's going to be a good thing.
We spoke about the other ones, didn't we, with the League Cup and County Cups when
we've
after
said
Christmas.
That, but no,
the fixtures at the start of the season.
You know, I've said, you know, and I don't know the league, we've mentioned the fixtures, but on the other side of it, I've always said this, I think our league is really professionally well run.
Yeah,
you know, we've come from leagues for league below,
and
you would never ever want to go back.
Much better, much better.
You know, me and Steve's won that league, unlike the other person that's had a go at us. But
you wouldn't
want to go down there. And that's a lot of respect to what we've got, and you know, and it's easy to criticise sometimes in league, and I think you take it for granted. But
even like the, you know, the do at the end of the season.
Yeah,
it's a good.
They give you a lot back. You know, the sub boards, even the kit, the bench kit we're getting. Mm. But you know, we've played teams in other leagues that don't look as professional as ours. You know, there are some that are now. They've all trying to play catch up, but we've led the way quite well, and you've got to give the league a lot of credit for that.
And, you know, I mean, you say to do. Sorry, say to do at the end of the season. I mean, I know there's people in this club that don't like it. They don't want to go. You know, and for me, I'm on the phone.
Have you ever sat on Phoenix's table? Yeah,
but, no, I mean, look, okay, we're quite so you've been doing it year in year out for the same. But I would say that
it's phenomenal.
It is a great evening.
I used to look forward to that every year, and when we was a Kent League club, when the Kent League was an evening though,
he
went to a lunchtime thing, and I was gutted.
Yeah.
Because the evening though, we had a great time, didn't we?
Yeah, we did.
I think one year I got up with a band. I was up.
It was me singing
La Bamba.
Yeah.
You know, but
it is one of those things for me. I mean, I'm always harassing Ray Dyer, so, you know. No one says, can I go? I don't mind. I'll go to the AGM as well. I love going to the AGM, sitting in there, you know, listening to the AGM and stuff. And I enjoy it. So I get to this sort of time of the year and I'm thinking, well, I've got to start harassing Ray in a minute. And, you know, now we've got a new secretary going as well. You're thinking, well, will I get to be able to go this year and not be able to go?
It's the last year at Wembley this year as well, isn't it? So, which some people are happy about, some aren't. It'd be interesting. Mm. I don't want about going to Windsor or something. Can they put something? But, I think on the other side of it, going back to the league, you know, new chairman's been in there nearly 2 years now, and it's a fresh new thing for him to take the league in a new direction. And you know, it's only positive. It's not going to go backwards.
No, exactly. That's what I was going to say. You know, like the way football is now at all levels, it's only going to get better.
Yeah.
I think you know, and look forward to it. To be honest.
Yeah.
Well, just had another tweet coming from Len Wilcox, and he's actually. Dan's stepdad, and he also put me through my refereeing course as well. He says, to be fair, if it was the Deodora for a while,
early 90s.
But people eventually got used to it. Yeah, I'll take time, but people will eventually start using a new name.
They will, but I don't think, I think the Ryman will never be forgotten, even in 50 years' time. What they've done, you know, to be a sponsor for 20 years is in this day and age as well, isn't it?
And the Bulls this year have got 20 on it, haven't they?
They have.
Yeah. 20 on, which is, And as I say, it's the longest running sports sponsorship deal in the UK history. And it says it'll come to the end.
Take some time, like next season.
You'll still be saying it in a while, you'll still say it. You know, you will do. And And that's, you know.
Then you try and, oh, play in the so-and-so league. Yeah, it used to be the Ryman League. You're trying to have a conversation, try and explain it.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I mean, is there anything other that we're allowed to talk about that came out of the secretary's meeting?
I don't think there's much more than, you know.
No, that
you know about. I think it was mainly dominated by this and obviously, you know, the future. Mm. So, no, there's nothing that, you know, it's just a normal mid-season, you know, chin wag. You know, respect things still the same, so, and whatever you want about the discipline and things like that. But yeah, no, it's no different.
That's fine. Happy days. So, I mean, what about Phoenix then? So, I mean, at the beginning of the season, you know, second season in the in the league. I mean, has it gone this time round compared to last time? I mean, what's the future coming up as well?
Well, I think. Well, I'll start. But I mean, first season we finished 14th, and from chairman's point of view and from the board's point of view, we was more than happy. We consolidated, we sort of learnt a lot off the pitch as well as on the pitch. Like from my point of view, it was a step up off the pitch, the hospitality you have to put on for the travelling committees and all that sort of thing, and the way it's much more professionally run. So that was a learning curve, and you nick ideas off of other clubs and, you know, just from match day programmes to, you know, our people... Oh, and it is a lot more professional. I really, really enjoyed it. To be honest, I thought we were welcome into every club, and we had some nice feedback from clubs about our facilities, our pitch being the number one thing. And I think when we went away, we enjoyed the hospitality we got. Second season, as I say, we sort of obviously we knew a bit more about how to behave off the pitch, and obviously Boylie speak more about on the pitch. He learned a lot. Because it is, and you get to know the teams, and obviously the other thing, teams get to know you a little bit more. As I say, we started like we was unbelievably fantastic start, and then as I say, with games, injuries, suspensions, bit of bad luck and a bit of bad form, we had 30 points after 14 games, and then we had 33 points after 23 games. We had 3 points in 9 games, and we just fell off a cliff. And from my point of view, still, you know, and this is for speaking for the whole of the board, we're still over the moon with what the squad has done and the position we're in and what Steve's doing with his team. But I also know his frustrations because as a manager, he's a winner and wants to win every game and gets so frustrated when, you know, he doesn't win or the team doesn't play as well as they are. But from a club's point of view, we're still the new kids on the block. Mm. We're still relatively unknown because our Phoenix Sports, we know Phoenix Sports and where they're from, but we still get asked questions like, where'd you come from, where are you? Because we're not obviously linked with a town or in our name. But we're still learning and we're enjoying it all. Obviously, we don't enjoy the losses and the bad performances, but we're realistic. It is, as I say, you know, when you are on a winning run and you sort of get near the top of the table, and we were a few points clear, you sort of start to think, blimey, yeah, could we go up again? But, you know, as a club, we're very happy to be in the position we are at the moment. But if for some miracle and Steve does it on the pitch and we could push on to the next level, facility-wise, we're not a million miles away. But it's still a lot of, you know, it is... it's hard, as I say, success breeds problems, and the majority of the problems are financial problems. Whether it's facility improvement, squad improvement, it's finances. Mm. And, you know, we're lucky with some of our sponsors, and as a club, we have budgets and we can improve the ground, but, you know, we haven't got a massive sugar daddy sitting behind us. We've got some good people involved, but... The next step is a big, big step, as I say, with Keith when he was in at Ryman Prem and the sort of budgets you're up against there and the size of the clubs. But we are still a progressive club and, you know, we're keen to keep improving year on year. So far, as I say, on the pitch, Steve's done the talking on the pitch. It's just been a straight curve up. And off the pitch, we've been improving the facilities that you may have seen.
Yeah, the bowl, superb.
Great
bowl. The boys were enjoying it when I left.
Great
bowl. The
British Borough boys had a right good time, didn't they?
I was just saying, and I think that the pitch is something, our pitch gets a lot of football. Our reserves playing a step six league, the Southern Counties East Division One, so it's used a lot, and our sort of premier youth sides use it on a Sunday, so it's getting three, sometimes four games a week, so it gets a lot. But I think it stands up as one of the.
I've got to be honest. I thought it was very, very decent.
Yeah,
for the time of year and like a lot of games on it. I thought it held up quite well.
It didn't have any work, obviously, because I went down there at quarter past 10.
Was it ever
Friday.
In doubt for the game Saturday?
I went down there at quarter past 10 on the Friday, fully covered
with
snow.
Yeah, I mean,
I went back down there at 4 o'clock, it was gone, it was wet. And from that, when I went back down there at 4 o'clock, I thought, no, this never be off. It was wet, but
it was a little
overnight.
Bit in the middle, it was overnight.
I went back down here at quarter 10 on a Saturday morning, and it was a little bit crisp where a frost got into it, but no, it was never that.
No.
4 o'clock, I didn't even bother going down here early doors on a Saturday. No.
We are quite lucky with the natural drainage, but the pitch, as I say, it does stand up, and that would be my one disappointment of this level of going up. You know, obviously, but you know, you have all this with the ground gradings, you've got to have two sets of turnstiles, three for the Ryman Prem, you've got to have the perimeter fence, so it's all enclosed. There's nothing in the ground grading that says what the actual most important thing in my mind, the quality of the playing surface. You know, I'm not being rude, but there are some really poor pitches in this league.
That's my big bugbear that I say every week.
And you can go out there and you can have, you know, you can have all the fencing, you can have all that, but, you know, realistically, we're not averaging over 100, but we have got to have the facilities to hold 3,000, which, you know, never in a million years, but it'd be lovely if we did. But then the most important thing, really, is your playing surface, and there's not a ground grading rule that it's got to be up to a certain level.
There is, but no one knows what that level is, and that's the issue we've got. And people say, you know, we mention this most weeks.
Yeah, but I'll let Steve talk about on the pitch.
I spoke just before we go to Steve. I mean, I spoke to Terry from Brighton City Region, I think, last year when they were pushing up towards the playoffs and so forth. And I said to him, how sort of scary is that from a team that's just come up maybe a year before, 2 years before, you know, and then you've got to spend a lot of money to get your ground to Ryman North standards. And now all of a sudden then in your first season, second season, you're pushing for, you know, Ryman Prem standards. You know, you as a chairman, I said, how does that affect you in knowing that you've got to then go into your back pocket and then go into it again and keep having to keep going to your back pocket, you know, to improve the ground, and you're only getting a crowd of 100, you know, tops of 100.
It is hard.
You know, coming through
the... I would say, I mean...
You've done it twice, though, haven't
you? Yeah, I mean, the Football Foundation Facilities Fund, although our vice chairman has been through the funding process a few times, it is a hard process, but there is money out there. Mm. You only get, I think... When we got our lights and all that, was step six, it was 70% of funding. But step four, I think, is 50%. So there are pots of money out there to get. But, as I say, Steve House, the vice chairman, who went through the process of getting the funding for the lights and the stand and the hard stand, you know, and it is a lot of hours, manual out of work, getting the quotes, getting the, you know, the drawings, getting the planning done. Is hard work, but there is funding available that does help you with that. But as I say, if you're spending, that's 50%. So if you've got to spend, you know, 20, 30 grand, you've still got to find that.
Yeah.
And like you say, we don't get the gates that can help us. Luckily, we've got a big club, as I say, from top to bottom, we've got touching 40 teams. So, you know, we've got a good junior section and a good bar that we hire out, and that brings in revenue that helps that. But again, you're looking for help from sponsors as well, you know, which luckily we've mentioned a few times, Johnny Power, Mick Kent Metal, who's come in over the last sort of 4 or 5 years and been fantastic with the help he's done and helped us push on.
Built a stand, didn't he?
Yeah, built a stand with his firm, built a stand for us, which...
Which is fantastic.
Yeah, yeah, brilliant. And he's done numerous things for us.
So, I mean, you said about the youth size, Mr. Hatt. Do you actually go down, do you get any time to go down and see the youth size, maybe like the older youth size, to see if there's any special players in there to try and save a bit of money rather than going out and getting other players from elsewhere? I mean, do you go down?
Pop down there on a Sunday, normally picking the car up because it's left there on a Sunday night. But I'll pop down there. It's a big step up from Kent Youth League to Ryman. We've got a reserve team that play at step six. They play against first teams. And like I say, when I first took the job at Phoenix, our first team were actually playing in that league. So our reserves are actually playing in that league now. So ideally, the step up is from youth team football to see if they can establish themselves as a step six player. And then if there's anyone decently near, then we have a look at them from that from there on, you know.
So, I mean, what is there a rule then? So you're just saying that you and the reserve side are in the same league as you were in a few years ago. Is there what's the rule in then?
Two leagues difference.
Right, so they couldn't, if, you know, so if there's a team there,
yes, it's a good proof for our club.
They couldn't get promoted because they get stopped.
No, no. Two leagues. If we got relegated, they can go up. Right.
Yeah, if we're not relegated, they'd have to drop down. They'd have to drop down.
But it was an opportunity that we never knew about until someone pointed us in the direction. I mean, we always wanted a young reserve, or Steve wanted a young reserve side to that, to bring the youth through. Unfortunately, the Ryman 21s, I'm not knocking it, but there didn't seem to be enough teams in that league to keep the youngsters interested. There was like, I don't know, 10s or 11s in the league. So it got put to us that we could apply for this league, and we did upset a few teams in the league because we got in as
weren't a popular decision.
Phoenix reserves, and there's a lot of saying, well, this is not a step six, not reserve league, but we're like, well, we're not breaking any rules. And to be fair, that team was sitting mid-table. The results are a bit up and down on their day. They can be really good, but they are mainly youngsters
kids,
in there. So
there's a lot of under-18s in
there's
there.
There's a bit of naivety in there.
But it's good for them. They get roughed up a little bit. They're playing against first teams, and the games actually mean something. Yeah. You know, you're playing against teams for fighting promotion.
When I first went down there, they played in the old Screwfix, as it was. I don't know what it is now. But you're playing against like good teams then, like Taunton and Biddeford.
Brings you on.
Yeah. And a lot of the boys that's where I started down there. We ended up going into the first team, and it was the transition wasn't so difficult because you are getting. Did you say beat up?
You're getting bashed up,
and
that's,
you don't need it.
Yeah, you do.
Last season we had two players that come through, and both played Saturday against you. The 11 come on for Tyrus.
Yeah.
Was that right?
To be fair,
he was up front. He's 19, and the guy, because of our captain got injured, the 16. He's 19, and they were both playing in their reserves last season. It's not quite happened this season. Unfortunately. But you know, it's still a good option to have.
So you look at the trust me,
if there was players in there, I'll be all over it.
Yeah.
Because it does help.
Yeah, of course it does.
You know, it don't work like that all the time.
Is that the same for you at VCD as well? I mean, you look at players and you're...
No, we haven't got any. That's when the chairman spoke about that recently. You know, when I took over there, they didn't have a 21s anyway, and the under 18s were poor. I'm honest with you, it was like pub football, and it was just a waste of money. So the chairman decided to go another route. We have spoke about it this year because that's where we're struggling. You know, our bench, we've been struggling for numbers because we can't go and put youngsters through. And Steve will know, you know, in my time at Thamesmead, that, you know, I brought a lot of our youth team through. You know, we're talking 7, 8, 9 players that come through and played in the first team.
I was overriding the reserves.
Steve was with me.
They were leapfrogging.
Yeah, they were, because they were that good at that time. And
I had no one else really to pick from.
No.
In the end, my last season at Thamesmead, it was the youth team were, the year previous, a lot of them played, but they were still eligible to play for the youth team, and then they overrode the reserves, and I'm like, well, I haven't really got a team in.
No.
When I won the last season with Thamesmead, it was like Dad's Army.
Yeah,
I was calling me to come and play for us.
Yeah.
because there was no one else at the club.
Yeah, and we need that now. And you know, me and Gary spoke about it. The things are built up. You get some of these teams now that are doing really well, have had the same side for 3 or 4 years, and that sort of continuity together. Mm. And we had that when I was at Thamesmead, you know, some of these players like the playing for Steve now, Jack Hopkins and that, you know, they play for me since they were 12 years old, the Lee Dawsons, and you know, and by the six, they've been at the club for 4 years, and I know them, and I've brought them through from 16-year-olds into a first team. So you've got them for 4 years, and they're only 20 years old. Mm. And that togetherness, they know you, they know the club, they're trustworthy, they believe in everything, you know, you're the way that you want to play. And
they want to play for the club. That's
play
the main
for the club,
want to play
saves
them,
it money. You know, you build. As Steve's done now with Phoenix. You know, it saves you a lot of money. But them players got to start football somewhere. You know, the Glenn Pauls, when he first started, had to start in a youth side somewhere, and you know, all these established players now that are getting decent money for football were once, not that long ago, young lads, and you've got to bring them through. Yeah. So
we have that. It's
hard. Well, Thamesmead and Phoenix were exactly the same. You know, that you had no pots of money. You were competing against big clubs around us, weren't we, at the time?
Yeah.
Bigger than what we are. And Steve said, only a few years ago, Phoenix were in that league. Thamesmead were in the same. And the only way you can get them players is by bringing the youth in. And he's done that really well where he is now. Hopefully, you know, he's come through a club with us and he took it on to another level at Phoenix now. And that's what you've got to do for, you know, when you're only getting small gates and things like that. Can you find that little gem in there? And he has, and he's done it with Christy and things like that in his side. And I'm sure, you know, we're talking to Steve now about his management bit, but I think it sets you in good stead as well. When you do have the youngsters, with, you know, you talk to an experienced lad, but these youngsters are also raw. And you can, you know, as a manager, they listen to you more, and I think you get a little bit more belief with them as well.
You can mould them, can't you?
Yeah.
I mean, like, you've got a young lad from Phoenix, he's playing in reserve, doing well. You can mould him into, it's kind of like the character that you want him to be as well. You get a young kid from, I don't know, say, like, a Charlton example.
Yeah, they feel what
they're stepping down.
Yeah. And it's beneath them. I've seen that a lot with these playing in academies and all that, and it's a culture shock. They come down, it's, what is this? You know, and we've had it with, we had George King when we won the Kent League.
Man City.
He, Man City's under 21's captain, broke his kneecap, got released the same day as Owen Hargreaves. And he come down and he was okay, weren't he? And all of a sudden,
he was unplayable for a while.
He's now playing for Glebe.
Yeah.
He's lost his love of football.
Yeah.
But you do see it, you know, again, I'm a great believer that what we've tried to put in place at Phoenix, and it is hard to get them, because as the Steve's pushed the first team on so much, to get these youngsters, like you said, it's a big jump for them. But I like the fact that we've got a pathway from at Phoenix, from under sevens all the way to senior football, if they're good enough, that they can go through the system, get through to under 18s, get into the reserves if they do well there, and then hopefully it's just
don't get me wrong, I would love a youth team at Phoenix or Keith had at Thamesmead. I'd love that.
Yeah. It is hard. The other thing that we're competing with some at that youth level, there's a lot of bigger clubs. He's got the Bromleys with good youth sides, you've got Dartford's, you've got Welling, you know, again, there's a lot of competition at that level as well.
And it's the, and obviously, I was going to say this to Steve, you know, what you built at your club now, if you've got a manager like Steve that's seen it and seen how it's done, you know, you've had a difficult upbringing at Thamesmead, being under me, one thing you say, you're a law man, you as a Thamesmead, you've been there for years,
you played there,
you know, and it's great that you went on your own and full credit.
I had to, it was three years,
and you won everything in the reserves. You done such a great job, and to be fair, when the Phoenix job came up, it was a perfect fit. I said that to yourself, and it was, you know, and I always knew you were going to take the club on. But going back to the youth side of it, I think a lot of clubs don't know how lucky they are to have someone like yourself, even myself, that will look at these youngsters, because some, obviously, you know. Now, things have changed a little bit, how you can get personnel in with your Michael Powers and that, but you know, you've that's what you've got players from, that's why you've done so well. You've gone out and got them from lower leagues and got players to play for you.
Yeah.
You know, and where you have got such a great club, and obviously you know what they're like, and I'll let you talk about how nuts they are over there, and you can give it from another point of view than me, but it's enjoyable to come to play for Phoenix as well.
Well, like you say, when I first took the job, you know, and we were a step six club that, you know, hadn't really done anything in senior football. You know, I've never actually ever played against Phoenix.
Yeah.
Like as a player.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, no one really knew about him. And, but I think locally everyone knew that he had a lot of potential and all that. So that's the reason why I went for the job.
Especially when Steve and Andy came in.
Yeah, and I actually turned around and said to the board, like, when I took the job, I said, I want to make this club, like, you know, bigger than VCD and all these. And you must have thought I was raving mad at the time. Mm. But, you know, there was so many teams locally better than us. Mm. And we've bridged that gap now. It's like, you know, no disrespect, but we had the year from Belvedere's, year of Towns, yeah. Holmesdale's and all that. We had a count on it with pre-season friendlies and all that. And now, you know, we've played VCD this year, we're above them in terms of meeting the league. And I'll openly say, you know, look, we at the moment could maybe be in front of you guys. And that has been like, you know,
we've always looked up
the VCD. That gap now is very, very close, you know, and we're competing in the same league as them. Mm-hmm. And
I mean, how many players have you got from, you know, you sort of South, the league, the reserves, or from that sort of league there, up to where we are now? Have you still got any players at all that was with you from the start to now, or
when I first took the job? To be fair, when I won the Kent Invicta League, I walked in and the whole team walked out. I still remember. I went down one bell down the road and they tweeted, "Rest in peace, Phoenix." Mm. And I was like, "Okay, we won the league and we went and played them on the Saturday, and rest in peace, Phoenix. We lost our first game on April the 7th, you know." And so, I basically bought in a team of mates, really.
Yeah, experience. Players
who I played with and who I knew would win me the league. Mm-hmm. You know, and I bought like Woody, goalkeeper, good right, who played in the Ryman League and all that. Dean Keely's of this world.
Yeah,
and whatever we say about like Phoenix now, you've got to look back to them days here, because if it weren't for them, we wouldn't be where we are now. Mm-hmm. And we smashed that division, and that was an hard division to win. And so I always go back to them guys. That was a fantastic, because we never had a team. Mm. It was built as we was going along. Mm. And we had good characters, winners, Marcus Perrone, Lee Morgans and people like that, you know, and they were out to win football matches. Yeah. Mm. And so I always go back to them guys. And then basically when we got promoted to the Kent League, they all retired. They said, "No, we ain't going back up there, no chance," and maybe a couple of them come with me.
And, again,
and then I think that was Ryan Andrews came in that year. Ryan Andrews, he's probably the only one really. Mm. But I've still got a few boys, quite a few boys who won the Kent League with us, because
we wanted like to give
Russell
Bedford's chance.
And all that are still with us, and you know, but it was going from the Kent League to the Ryman League where it's a lot more commitment and things like that, and a few boys didn't want to commit, so there ain't as many left as
No, there's a lot more commitment for yourself as well, because obviously, you know, people don't know you work nights.
Yeah.
You know, every night, and he's off in a minute.
Probably 12 o'clock,
You know, it's a lot more effort. And you are competing, as you just said, with a lot more bigger clubs now, as well as, you know, you said about, you know, you've got us across the road and you've got the Thamesmeads and things like that. Well, you still were competing with them, but you were competing with the Belvedere's and that. Now it's sort of changed even bigger. You're competing with us, but you're also competing with the teams above us, the Dartfords and things like that.
Well, I look at it like locally now, we've got Welling and Dartford. Well, it used to be Welling, Dartford, VCD, Thamesmead, here in Belvedere. We were so far down the pecking order, but we're not now.
No.
So if you're a local player, going, "Yeah, I fancy, I wouldn't mind having a go down here." So hopefully that we start attracting better players to the club, where I say to people at the moment, we're not very fashionable. We're not very fact, because no one knows who we are really. You know, we was looking for a centre forward. Everyone knew we was looking for a centre forward, and I was looking for a decent centre forward. So I was maybe looking at people in the Ryman Prem. Mm. People in the Ryman Prem didn't even know who we were.
Yeah.
You know, but.
But do you think, obviously, and I said about you both being a match made in the club and yourself, and that is what attracted you, because, you know, a lot of people do talk about Phoenix, and I know in the Ryman League, you know, the home teams, when you go there, will talk about, you know, you clear them out the bar and what great lads you are and what a great sort of togetherness you've got. You're the same, so I know exactly what you're like. And that's an attraction as well, because people sit and think it's a club going forward. It's a club that, you know, do get a lot of backing off the pitch as well, because you have done remarkable. You know, I can talk about as an outsider. You have, as a club, you know, to come from where you have to where you are now in such a short period of time, you don't just need the team, you've got to have the backing.
Oh,
and they've done an unbelievable job, and you know
everything I've asked for, I've got.
But from their point of view, they're sitting there, can see such a manager that's pushing forward so much, all they can do is want to back him. So that's added pressure to you as well.
Look, we want to back him. I mean, obviously, and Steve knows this, as I said a little while ago, success breeds problems.
Yeah.
And when you've got someone who's done well on the pitch as Steve has done in the last five seasons, it's a little bit scary for some who've been on, like I've been the chairman for 15 years, but relatively young man, but there's some of the guys who have been at Phoenix a lot longer than me. And they see, you know, see what they're doing and realise how much we've got to spend off the pitch to keep up with what he's doing. It does ring alarm bells with some, and it's like, wow, put the brakes on a little bit. But how can you turn around to a manager and say,
You've got to keep the momentum.
I look at your Chathams and your Urban Bays and all that, and I think, well,
which the ball? Yeah. No one ever thought they'd done that.
No, that's right.
But I think the one thing which I like to promote, which we could, and something I've seen when you go around to all these clubs, a lot of the non-league clubs have got. And I'm not being ripped, but like older committees. You go to a lot of them, and they're a lot older guys. Our committee, we've got a couple of older, but the majority of us are like in our sort of 40s, early 50s. So we're relatively young as a board. Yeah. And I think that's one of the things I see, certainly our relationship or as a board with the players and the manager. There's a lot of, you'll see the players come in, and it probably happens at all clubs, but we have a laugh with the players as well. We're happy to stand in the bar and have a drink with them. And I don't always see that at all clubs I visit. There is a divide between the dressing room and the committees. Yeah. And I think that's what we're trying, when players come and join us, is the fact that they do join a club where they can, you know, have a laugh and have a beer and some banter with the ball as well, it does create a good atmosphere.
Exactly, you want people to stay at the club after a game. Like we had a good crack with the Billericay lot. We've still got our WhatsApp group now, a couple of them have moved to Australia, but there was a core of us, there was only about eight.
Yeah, but that's
and we'd stay at the ground till about 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
You know,
that's the thing, and also, I will say that about the younger people coming through now, they haven't got the same sort of...
The drink driving thing is an issue nowadays. Me and my chairman speak about it, well, why don't they stay for a drink? Well, they've got to get across the walk, you know. Yeah. They're travelling an hour, we've got to try and get them in.
That's true.
You know, I had the togetherness with eight or nine at Thamesmead. You had it, obviously, we mentioned the Den Keelys and things like that all the time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and it is. But, you know, I think... And I was just about to say this to Andy, he took the words out of my mouth about the young committee, or the younger committee. And it is a big thing. You go to Phoenix, and it is, you know, and the one thing I will say, it's professional. Before I say anything else, you know, I'm not taking that out. But it's also very enjoyable. You know, it's no thing that I go over there and so do my chairman and that on a Sunday. They're good. They're people that you want to, you know.
You said that when I see you Wednesday, wouldn't you? Said, oh, lovely people. You
love it.
I wish this meeting was last week. I was starting about 9 o'clock.
You know, I meet up with her, and obviously, you know, me and Steve go back a long way anyway. But it's a place where, you know, it's a fun place to be as well.
Yeah.
You know, it's a fun place. When there is pressure and that on you, even as Steve's a manager, whatever happens, after a certain amount of, and he's like me, he's an awful loser in himself.
Terrible.
Okay, in himself, not as a person, but in himself. But they make you relax after a while, and then it's back on to football. You have a laugh, you do your bit.
He did have a pop at me the other week, though. He did say, you've got to learn to, you know, smile after getting beat. I said, how do I do
you're sulking, you know? Like, losing, trying to sort beers in his hand, go, look, it's done. You know, after the game, I'm one of them.
Yeah.
Win, lose or draw after the game, it's disappointing you lose, obviously, or whatever. But, I mean, once I've had a couple of beers, I'm like, it's done.
Move on next.
But I understand it, but it takes you...
Yeah, it does.
He's fuming. It's
a bad thing.
It's not a bad thing. No, that's it. That's what you got in you, the winning mentality.
From my point of view, you know, start of the season, we were flying, we're 8 points clear, and I remember, like, maybe a few people was getting a little bit carried away around the club.
Yeah.
And I can get it, because I think a few of them thought, we was only in the Kent League 2 years, and all of a sudden, second year, we just absolutely blitzed it, and all of a sudden, we're doing it right. I was happening again. Whoa.
Pattern, you know.
You can't think like that. We had an horrendous injury list, and I think the worst one, we played Bury at home, and my goalkeeper and my centre midfield was the only two regulars I had. The rest were out, and it was madness, and it was playing Tuesday, Saturday, and we just couldn't, it was boring players, you know. And it was getting silly. you know, and I think once the players come back from the injury, their form weren't as good as it was beforehand. We've got back into a bit, you know, winning. We're winning a few more games now, and but don't get me wrong, playoffs, I will never give that up. You know, we've been in it 2 years and whatever, but at the start of the season when I got the squad together, I thought, well, we can have a good season this year. And I weren't ever thinking, oh, mid-table, this, I've got to go in the league and I've got to try and win it. And that's the way it is. It's the way I am. And, you know, like I say, if we do get in the playoffs, which is a long shot, he's getting married in Dorset, and I said, well, what when are you getting married? I went, oh, the end of April. Well, can you do it the week after? And this is before the season even kicked off, you know. So I already had that in my head that I thought,
Well, John's just tweeted it. He says, Dave, with the greatest respect to everyone concerned, there is no value to a sponsor at this level of football. It's all about finding the right person to get involved. I got involved after a 40-year stint of living and breathing West Ham. A younger Andrew Mortlock used to knock on the door of the Thames Lounge, and I opened the door. Now 20 years on from there, I am so non-league football. So I'm so into non-league football because it's honest and true. Please God, some of the lads that come through the ranks go on to the bigger clubs and get the big bucks. But it's raw football that drives me these days. I just wish I'd done this 20 years ago. Love it, big style. And someone called Jamie Brown said, evening all. Well said, Keith. Phoenix is a top club, run well from top to bottom, a very nice bunch of people, and the togetherness is top class. The future's bright, come on in Phoenix.
Yeah, I've been there five years, and I've had five fantastic years there. John is like, obviously, he's a dream to me, you know, he's backed me 100% as well. He don't mix his words, does he? You know?
No, he says it's.
But for me, I've got a very good relationship with him, and
no, it was good. I remember, because I used to have said it there, I used to go to West Ham with John when he was, we was both into it. He was a season ticket over in the Thames Lounge, and I went with him, and his kids used to go. And then I didn't see him for a few years, but sort of our paths went different ways. And then his brothers were coming down to Phoenix watching the games, and he came on one New Year's Eve about 5 years ago, and I went to him, what have you been doing? He's like, no, he was so busy with his work and that. He said, I don't do football anymore. He fell out of love with West Ham because, as like he says, overpaid prima donnas. And I went, John, you've got to come down here. I said, it's real football. I said, there's a little like money, but it's, you know, peanuts really in the scheme. But I said, it's just enjoyable. You'll like the bar. The people down here are great. He went, well, I might have a bit of that. And we brought him in. And to be fair, he hasn't looked back and we haven't looked back. You know, he's a mate of mine and he enjoys everything about the non-league. And I said to him, once you get used to, obviously when you've watched the Premiership or Premier League or that level for a long time, it takes a while to get used to non-league football. But once you get used to, I mean, you could give me a season ticket for West Ham now and I'll tell you where to poke it. I'm non-league all day, so I enjoy it more. It's more exciting. You know,
more people should think like that.
I fall asleep watching Premier League when you say
and this is why I get a little bit disappointed about crowds. You know, people say they enjoy it over Phoenix and whatever. We say, oh, I'll go and watch a game and I can have a beer afterwards and all that. And our bar is always like, it's a friendly place. And I thought I think people should enjoy it. I saw
something on Facebook, on the Harlow Facebook page during the week, last week. And, you know, you've got a big game against York, probably one of the biggest games the club's had in a long, long time. You know, second round of the trophy against a team that was in like league football the year previous. You know, and you think, well, everybody wants their beat of that. And there was a couple of fans there going, oh, I'm not going to make it today because I've been offered a ticket to go and see Spurs, and I'm going to go and see Spurs. So I don't think I'm going to make it back in time. Well, hang on a minute. This is the biggest game this club's played, your club that you say you love has played, and you're going to go off to play.
You know, everyone knows I'll go and watch games on a Monday or Wednesday, Friday, Thursday, when it's, and I don't go and watch. You know, you watch them because you're looking for players in there, but I probably enjoy going and watch a non-league game more than you're going to watch like Spurs, or even sit indoors and watch it on TV. You do need the odd night if we can have a rest, but because one, you're part of it, two, you can interact, you can see more, you know, and just because we're managers, it makes no difference. Yeah. We're still football fans as well. Yeah, and that's how you get the buzz into non-football, is by that. You can stand like the people that have been tweeting in. You know, they stand on the side. They can hear everything Steve says. Mm-hmm. They can hear everything Glenn says, I say. And you know, rightly or wrongly, they agree with it, disagree, but they feel part of it.
Yeah, they can
they feel
opinion.
That they've part of it. They go in the bar.
My man
talk
was at the game Saturday. He was at the game and they were sat behind, they were sitting right behind the dugouts. And he said, I don't really like to sit behind the dugouts. He said, but it was actually refreshing to sit behind both dugouts, he said, and listen to what Stimmo was saying and listen to what you guys were saying. He said it was different, he said, but both constructive.
Yeah.
But he said it was good to hear that. You know what I mean?
A supporter will get an idea. Even my critics sometimes come and stand behind when we're away. Mm. And they might get an idea why you've done that, why you've done that. They do the same with Steve or a supporter will.
You
but
do watch a different game from there.
Of course
there.
You do. It's pretty different. You know? They know the pressure of it. But, you know, at Phoenix or Thurrock or a BCD, these supporters can go in the bar after where the players are standing, where the chairman's standing,
they can have a chat, an opinion.
As long as they're not respectable, they're part of that club then. Mm. So,
and you know them personally.
And they do, and they know you personally.
And that's
what
I think more people
should,
like the Witham Town, James, what's his name, the Witham Town fans.
Yeah, James, who's coming to us on Saturday.
You know, a fantastic lad. Yeah. You know, I love that guy. I think he's brilliant. I follow his Twitter and everything. You go and watch him, and he sings all. And do you know what? Yeah. He loves it. And we've got a couple of our supporters that come that you know, special needs or whatever. Mm. But you see this boy, we've got this one, you know, Jack, and he stands where the players come in and out, and they'll make a fuss with him, shake his hand. Yeah. He's buzzing. He's an adult.
And you can't.
Where else can you get that? They wouldn't get anywhere near him. And the players make a fuss of him. We make a fuss of him, and it is, and you see that in a lot of the grounds, and it's
very family oriented, isn't it, at this level?
We've got Whitman coming in a few weeks' time, and I'll speak to Adam and see when we can get James to come in with him as well, because
it's
brilliant.
I've got to be honest,
about crowds, the one thing I think I read it on his Twitter as well, he said, I want to make myself sound like 100 Whitman fans.
Yeah, I read that.
That was... Yeah, I mean, we played him last week, and
He don't stop all the whole game.
I said to one of their players, "I went, God, he's mad, isn't he?" I ain't played in front of him before. Yeah. Like it was like.
Well, I say when we go away,
fair play.
You know, and we take like 20, 30 away of us.
Yeah.
And they make I think it makes a difference.
Players like it, don't they?
Of course they do.
Of course they do. They like it. No matter if it's, you know. Yeah, they do.
It's one of those ones when you go down to somewhere, especially one I noticed was when you went down to Brighton, it's the region. You go down to there, and you've got like their ultras one end, and. Got the Isle of Ones the other end, and it's the bits and backs and forwards. And I still remember going down there for the first time, and we were sitting in there, a tiny little stand there by the clubhouse, and standing there and sitting in there. And there was me and a couple of kids, and we were just sitting there in the front row. And it was like the only way you could describe it was what you used to see on the TV on World of Sport with the old girls with the for the wrestling, you know, with the
bags on the hats.
And there was about four or five old girls sitting behind the back of us in a little group, sitting right in the back of this stand. It was all those sort of little things that they were saying, and you just expected the handbag to come over the top of your head at any point. But it was that type of thing, and that's what makes it. Because especially, I've noticed it more there than probably anywhere else, that the spread that they've got down there of people, the youngsters in the ultras, and then you've got the older generations there as well. And not just the older male generation, but the female generation as well that they've actually got at that club. Yeah. And it's quite a spread out sort of like fan base from the youngsters to the
other. I mean, that's what we had with Billericay. When we won the league, that was pretty much exactly the same. We had the older ones, then sort of the middle-aged ones, then the kids. But there was times at the end of the season where I'm thinking, there's people ringing me up and all that. And there's one lad, and I don't know if he'd be watching, but Rich Mann, he always stuck in my head. Like, if I left, because I got to know him on a personal level, he'd crucify me if I'd have left. But it was little things like that, saying, oh, I don't want to leave this sort of, him and a few of the others, because you sort of get to know them in the bar and around the place, and it's the emotional
That's what we try to create with the
Even like, kids. It's like the team that won the Kent League, like, you know, a thing popped up on my Facebook yesterday, and it was a couple of years to the bay that we went to Bodmin and won 2-0, and a couple of pictures there, and I've posted them to the two boys who was up there.
Mm-hmm.
It's our best weekend of my life in football and all that. And like I say, they're no longer at the football club, but they'd come back like that.
Yeah.
You know.
And that's the thing as well, isn't it? Because players do move around freely, you do get them emotional ties with these clubs. And you know, if one of my ex clubs come back, you'd have to think about it. That's one of the reasons again why I went to Thurrock this year. And, you know, it's, like I say, I think the non-league thing is so much better than the pro game for that particular reason.
Well, John's just, one last tweet he's put in, Dave, it's called genuine people supporting non-league football. And I think that's probably a good way to finish, if I'm honest, because the time has run away from us, unfortunately. But so before we go, we've had, of course, the team of the week, and of course there is the trophies, the Chesson Trophies team of the week.
Before you do, can I interrupt? They sorted me out some trophies the other week in a late dash to get trophies. They opened up for me, so thank you guys.
Fair play.
Yeah, around Christmas as well. They opened up for me.
And it was Christmas Eve, was it?
No, it was nothing. It was.
What did you do?
I just
put your name on the bottom of them.
I just
my family come round at Christmas.
No, it's my coach and mum. No, but they sorted me out. So thanks, guys. I forgot to mention it last week.
So I mean, literally, as we say, it's the Chesson Trophies, John Oates, Ryman team of the week, and it was between Worthing, Chesson, Dulwich Hamlet, and Horsham. We had 229 people in the boat over 48 hours. 6% went for Worthing, 18% went for Chesson, 4% went for Horsham, and the runaway winners of this week, 72% was Dulwich Hamlet.
Yeah,
so probably, you know, seeing
what they did. Horsham would have got a bit more than that. That's a good win.
But the trouble is, look at Dulwich, we said about Gates.
The supporters. supporters are on there. Yeah.
But that's why they've won it.
But in all fairness, you know, it's. If anybody wants to come on, any of the clubs out there in the South or the North or in the Prem that want to come on to the show and have a chat and, you know, talk about their club, i.e., you know, the likes of Romford, the Waltham Abbeys, or anybody that's close, or even people a little bit further away, and say we've got Greenwich Borough and Gary Alexander going to come in and join us next week. If you want to come and join us, if you want to come and join us in the studio with me, Glenn and Keith, that'd be fantastic. If not, if you want to join us on the phone, then we can do that with you as well. You can come in to, you know, promote your club from the football you play to the car boot sale you might be having a week later. Why not come in and promote it and talk football with us? And don't be, you know, a lot of people talk to me and say they're really concerned about coming in and they don't know what's going to happen. We always describe it as just four or five guys sitting around a table talking football. And as you can see tonight on Facebook Live and you can hear on Hawks Radio again on Wednesday, that's exactly what it's all about. Just trying to promote this fantastic league and promote your fantastic club. So if you want to come on, contact me through Facebook or through Twitter, or contact Keith or contact Glenn, and we'll get you sorted out into our diary and get you into the show. As we said, next week it's going to be Greenwich Borough. They're with us next week. The week after, we've got Corinthian Casuals on the phone with us as well. And then on the 4th, so on the 6th of Feb, we have got with us Carl Bates and Barry Swain, who do all the commentaries and stuff for BBC. They will be with us, Barry in the studio, and he'll be with us in the studio for that one. But as I said, as we always say during the week, keep yourself safe, enjoy your football at the weekend, hope you will get the results that you want, and we'll be back here next week, 7 till 9 on Monday live on Facebook, 7 till 9 on Hawks Radio on the following Wednesday as well, where you can hear the show on the radio. But until then, keep yourself safe, keep your family safe, and we'll see you here same time next week. Goodbye.
Thank you, guys.
Cheers.
Yeah, thanks for that.
That's all right. No, it's quality.
Cheers.